Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today we'll see 28 July 2018 current affairs. The topics we are going to see today includes these five. Let's see them in detail. First topic is the recent highs that the Sensex has reached currently. Over the past few months, the Sensex and Nifty has been seeing frequent fluctuations of ups and downs, and yesterday the Sensex has reached all-time high. Before getting into the fluctuations, we must know what Sensex is and what Nifty is. First is Nifty. Nifty stands for National Stock Exchange 50. So this is actually a weighted average of 50 Indian company stocks varying across 12 sectors. It was first launched in the year 1996 and it has changed exponentially to its current form in 2018. The Nifty is owned by India Index Services Products, which is a wholly owned subsidiary of NSE Strategic Investment Corporation Limited. And previously, this was calculated by a different method, but now due to increase in market orientation, nowadays it has been shifted to free float methodology. It means the Nifty value varies according to market fluctuation constantly throughout the day. Next, we'll see about Sensex. Sensex stands for S&P Bombay Stock Exchange Sensitive Index, and it is calculated with 30 well-established sound industrial companies based on Bombay Stock Exchange. It also has a dollar-linked version, which is called as Dollex 30. Some of the other largest stock exchanges across the world are as follows: London Stock Exchange in London, New York Stock Exchange, Shanghai, Australia, Tokyo, Hong Kong, Toronto, Nasdaq, etc. And in India, other stock exchanges beyond NSE and BSE includes Calcutta Stock Exchange, Cochin Multi-Commodity Exchange, which is used for commodity trading, Derivative Exchange for derivatives, OTC Exchange, Pune Stock Exchange, and Interconnex Exchange. As I said before, the fluctuations now are due to one major reason, which is the increased buying by foreign institutional investors. This increased buying indicates the economic growth of India and the trust the foreign institutional investors place on India when compared to other emerging economies across the world. Another important trend in Indian stock exchange market is that when compared to other stock exchanges of well-developed countries like America, almost 70% of the stock exchange is dominated by developed companies, whereas in India, the developed companies, that is so-called blue chip companies, constitute only 3-4% of both stock exchanges. This indicates that Indian economy is still dominated by the informal sector. This is both a positive and a negative trend. The positive trend is that India accommodates both smaller and the larger companies. The negative trend is that the informal companies still stay informal. The second issue we are going to see today deals with the Eritrea and Ethiopia thaw in relations and the outbreak of peace. The dispute between Eritrea and Ethiopia started way back almost 15 years ago concerning a small border town called as Badami. We can locate it over here in map. A boundary delimitation commission was also set up in 2000 and it awarded that the town goes to Eritrea, but the Ethiopia failed to accept the solution and the dispute between both the countries never ended. This dispute led to mass migration, especially to European countries, and the incident which happened in 2000 year where a whole lot of 100 people drowned in an island near Italy gained international media attention. The peace accord, which was signed in the year 2000, was also not implemented, and this affected the relations between the whole African Union. Both Ethiopia and Eritrea lie in a region called as Horn of Africa. This region is strategically located and it includes four countries, namely Eritrea, Ethiopia, Djibouti, and Somalia. All the four countries are economically poor and stuck with poverty for several years. And this forms the easternmost projection of African continent and it's very close to Indian Ocean. It is also bordered by Red Sea and Gulf of Aden. There's constant ethnic strife, intra-African conflict, diseases, which leads to poverty and famine in the African region. India and Horn of Africa are linked in multiple ways. Number one is India is involved in anti-piracy operations involving Indian Navy patrol ships in the region, protecting the marine security of the area. India-Africa summit, which was held in New Delhi in the year 2015, also emphasized bringing back peace in the whole region, which will contribute to the stability of Indian Ocean region. The increasing Chinese presence in the Horn of Africa area poses a security threat to India. For example, a small country, Djibouti, houses the marine military base of two big countries like United States of America and China. This internal conflict between USA and China may even contribute to instability of Djibouti in time to come. The next issue we are going to see today is Draft Personal Data Protection Bill 2018. This bill was drafted by a committee headed by Justice Sri Krishna Committee, which was constituted almost a year back. The committee for the first time defines what a personal data is. It states a data which is related to a natural person, either directly or indirectly, to some characteristics or traits can attribute to what is called as natural personal data. And it also brings in a new concept called as right to be forgotten. It means that the individual has a right to delete or correct the disclosure of one's personal information, which may be misleading or embarrassing or sometimes even irrelevant. And such disclosure must not only be seen lawfully, but also in a way that it is fair and reasonable. This act applies not only just to all the businesses in India, but also other new coming activities such as profiling, which could cause a widespread public harm. The data also reinforces the concept of penalties and as well as compensation to the affected parties in the bill. Failure to take prompt action from the data security provider will also impose a high fine of from 5 crores to 2% of the turnover of the whole security firm. The Justice Sri Krishna Committee constituted the whole bill of personal data protection based on the 7 principles. The first principle is that the law which is drafted should be flexible and it should take into consideration the changing technologies and evolution instead of just being static and rigid. The second principle is that the law must apply not only just to the private sector providers but also to the government entities which may involve the personal data of various people. The right to consent is given a very important place in the Personal Data Protection Bill. The consent should be genuine, well-informed and meaningful instead of just using force to get consent. The processing of data should be very minimal in whenever and wherever it is very much necessary and it should be for the purpose for which the data is to be sought for. The entities which control the data should be fully accountable for any data they hold and they process. The enforcement of data via this framework must be monitored by a very high-powered statutory authority. And the enforcement of penalties is also very much important for the wrongful act as it encourages uniformity. The Draft Data Protection Bill 2018 did not comment anything about the Aadhaar issue, which was recently in tussle between the government and the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court in various judgments in the past years has enforced that the right to privacy is an essential part of Article 21, Fundamental Rights of Indian Constitution, and every Indian citizen has right to have privacy as the basic right. The committee also enforced that the ownership of data must be based on mutual trust and data should not be seen as a property and ownership. The committee recommended setting up of data protection authority at a national level to prevent the misuse of personal information of both private people and the institutions. The committee also emphasized a special mention on protecting the data relating to children with the view of the increasing crime relating to children with the increase in technological development. The companies which use the data relating to children are barred from monitoring the behavioral issues of the children, tracking children, targeted advertisements and processing which are not in best interest of the child. And currently there are two types of entities which get access to the personal data with respect to children. The first include the services provided by the entities such as YouTube Kids, Hot Wheels and Walt Disney, which majorly encompass the video service providing. And the second type includes the media services offered by Facebook and Instagram. It must also be emphasized that the whole data protection bill set by the committee is still in the draft stage and the government has the right to eliminate or add furthermore points to the bill before tabling it to the parliament. The next issue is regarding educational reforms in India. It says the faculty numbers dipped by 2.34 lakhs in past 3 years. This is a data provided by AISHE, which stands for All India Survey on Higher Education Report 2017 and 18. This is an annual web-based census which is conducted in India to study the higher education sector since 2010. And the data offers that in the year 2015 and 16, there was almost 10 lakh professors in higher educational institutions in India. But currently, it stands in the year 2017 and 18 at a point of 8.88 lakhs. This information is very much useful for Ministry of Human Resources for making informed policy decisions regarding the development of the educational sector in India. The data is being collected for the survey based on the following parameters. Number one is teachers, student enrollment ratio, various welfare programs, the examination conducted and its results, the educational finance offered by the government and the private sector, the infrastructure of the educational institutions, and also other educational indicators like institution density, that is the number of people studying in the institution, cross enrollment ratio, pupil to teacher ratio, gender parity index, per student expenditure for the education, etc. The data also indicates the improvement in gross enrollment ratio from 19% in the year 2010-11 to currently 25% in the year 16 and 17. The gross enrollment ratio stands for the ratio of the enrollment in higher educational institution of age group 18 to 23 years. And this is the first time that the survey involved collection of data from the teachers exclusively using a platform called as Gurujan. The last issue we are going to see today is India to give flash flood warning to other Asian nations as well. India has been recently designated as the nodal center for preparing flash flood forecast by World Meteorological Organization. Via this designation, India will issue advance warning regarding the flash floods to other Asian nations like Vietnam, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, and Thailand. India will also be able to issue warnings to Pakistan, but Pakistan has refused to participate in the agreement with India. India is yet to work out a proper mechanism via which it will be able to predict the flash floods. In India, the Central Water Commission monitors India's dam across the country. It warns against the rising water levels in the various reservoirs in the country, which are usually taken as the signs for imminent floods. The organization has recently tied up with Google to develop a software application which will indicate the rise in water level, especially during heavy rainfall. As with India, several other Southeast Asian nations also received a rainfall via monsoon. Since monsoon is highly fluctuating nature, it becomes highly essential to predict the monsoon in order to avoid the consequences of high rainfall and floods. India will be using combination of satellite mapping and ground-based observation system to develop a system called as flash flood guidance system in order to provide information to other Asian nations. But we have to know about the World Meteorological Organizations for the prelims perspective. It is an intergovernmental organization which was constituted in the year 1950. It currently includes 191 member states and territories, and India is also a part of the organization. The organization is headquartered in Geneva, Switzerland. WMO became a specialized agency for United Nations, especially in the sphere of weather and climate. It also does research with respect to geophysical sciences and operational hydrology. The World Meteorological Organization and United Nations Environment Programme jointly created Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. This IPCC releases essential reports relating to environment and climate change. The key priorities of World Meteorological Organization includes disaster risk reduction, global framework for climate change, World Integrated Global Observing System, Aviation Meteorological Services, polar and high mountain regions, capacity development, and also with respect to governance. WMO also releases these following reports. This can be studied for the prelims perspective. Thank you.